Morning, ladies and gents. My name is Simon Brown, Just One Lap. Today, we're going to be looking at income investing in a sense. We're looking at bond ETFs from 1nvest, and we're looking at the REIT. There are local and there are offshore. I'm joined by Wehmeyer Ferreira, Executive Director at 1nvest.
Thank you for having me.
No, absolutely. And thanks for everyone who's attending and coming in. If you've got questions, you're welcome to drop them into the question box. We will take those as we go through. There's time afterwards as well. We are recording. This then will be put onto our YouTube channel later this afternoon. But let's kick off and let's go straight into and there are three here. There's the local bond one, which is ETF BND, and then there's the GGB, which is offshore, and then the ETF USD. We'll delve into each of them. I've dropped the dividend yields down there. Just a quick point, you'll note on the ETF USD, there's an asterisk around the yield because it wasn't paying yields, but we will get into that. A couple of questions came through ahead of us talking around, okay, we've had a really good run in bonds. Bond yields on developed and emerging markets have been at not record levels, but it's certainly multi-decade highs in some cases. So great yields. The question then is twofold. When we start seeing the likes of Jerome Powell, the Bank of England, we've seen it at the ECB already, the MPC at some point, when they start cutting rates, is there a direct relation between the rate of a government bond versus the repo rate or the case maybe? Or is it a sort of a bit of a correlation, but not necessarily a direct correlation?
Yeah, I think, Simon, if you normally think about equities and you think about something like earnings, and let's use earnings as the comparison to a yield, then if earnings fluctuate, then normally stocks, assuming their multiple stays the same, moves in a similar direction. Whereas with bonds and with yields, you've got firstly the inverse correlation or reaction. So if yields go up, the price of a bond goes down, which is bad. So in a rate hiking cycle, it's bad for bonds. Mm-hmm. And then secondly, there's not a direct correlation between the percentage points of rates increase and the capital appreciation or depreciation of the bond, because it's expressed as a percentage of the coupon. So again, let's use an example. A bond is at par value, which is 100. It is paying 8% yield, which means you get an 8 Rand coupon.
Yeah.
If in the future the yield changes to say like 12%, then you need to say my 8% coupon is going to stay static. If I now express that 8 Rand coupon at a 12% yield, what is my capital value of my bond do? And that then decreases in that ratio, rather than being one thing has gone from 8% to 12%. So now my product has moved 4%. That's not the way you should think about it. So it's a bit of an inverse around thinking about equity, or coming from a traditional equity background, where I think most investors on the JSE are used to equities and thinking about earnings and earnings multiples and how something is cheap or expensive. Bonds are works different to that.
And that's a great point. I mean, what we will see, and if we roll forward a couple of years and we see developed and South African bond yields coming down, we might be getting less yield, less a coupon over time. But what we will potentially get is an appreciation in the bond. In other words, less income coming at us, but we'll get a capital gain in a sense.
Exactly. So if you think about the current cycle we're in, if rates are cut aggressively, it means that yield goes down, which means the price of your bond essentially goes up, which means the value of your product goes up. So you might lose on the income side, but you gain on the capital side.
Gotcha. The offshore one, which is a group of seven, the G7, which is US, Japan, France, Italy, Germany, UK, and Canada, but very much dominated, as are most offshore or global products, very much dominated by the US, of course, because their economy is a quarter of the global economy. So no surprise that they dominate in that as well.
Yeah, if you look at indices, and again, let's go back to equity. Equity, normally the company that's got the highest market cap has got the highest weight in the index.
Yeah.
Similar with bonds, and sometimes that's the criticism to bond indices, is they're actually saying the government that issues the most debt. So almost the person that's got the most debt to repay has got the highest weighting in the benchmark. And the US in the G7 bond index has got about 55% of the index weights, which means if you think about the G7 countries, the US have got 55% of the debt out there in the market. So they've borrowed the most from the market. But yes, that's why I think, especially if you go into global indices, regardless if it's equity, property, or fixed income, everybody always focuses on the US because the US gives guidance to global growth, macro environment, geopolitical even. But the reality is they also dominate the indices from an issuance perspective, and it's no different with the global government bond index.
Yeah. And there's also, because you mentioned there, it's currency. So on the global one, I'm going to take my ZAR, and on the JSE, I buy the ETF, ETF GGB, and I hold that ETF. But of course, in the background, that ZAR has been turned into dollars, into euros, into Canadian dollars. So there is a currency impact. And we were saying before we came on air, there is a possibility out there or a future out there where we see sort of the rand strengthening, but the dollar strengthening at the same time against the others.
Yeah, I think as South Africans, we've gotten used to thinking about the rand as structurally declining, which I don't think is wrong if you go back to macroeconomics 101 and you think about interest rate differentials and growth differentials, the rand should weaken. But it's not a straight line profile. So it's not saying I can bank 6% rand depreciation every year and I should factor that into my performance. I think as you mentioned to me earlier, you saw a period in the early 2000s where the rand actually strengthened over a five-year period against the dollar. So I think we should be careful as South African investors thinking about a global asset class doing X and let me add on 6% rand depreciation. And that's what I'm expecting out of this that asset class. Because if you think about it, the US, in terms of global markets, are late to cut. You've seen in around Europe and UK, you've seen Canada starting to cut, the US not cutting yet. Market is only pricing in about 25 bps in November. So that means the dollar should be strong, just going on that metrics. And if you think about South Africa, the market have priced in quite a lot of bad news pre-election. And if you think about post-election, the sentiment has been quite positive with the outcome of the election, the outcome of the formation of the government. Eskom, the electricity supply being a lot better the last 3-4 months than we saw in 2023. So a bit of optimism building. So you can see rand strength as a possibility. And if you overlay that with over the last couple of years, we've seen global investors being absent in the South African market. If you look at the JSE stats around equity and bond flows, there's been net outflows from foreign and emerging market investors. And once you see the positive sentiment coming back into the market and you see foreign investors coming back, that's also going to create demand for rand. So yes, you're right. You need to be careful of taking the history as a forward prediction, especially on the rand, around building that into your return profile.
Yeah, I take your point. I mean, if we roll that profile out multiple decades, you will get a nice smooth chart. But of course, in the short term, the rand is often referred to as the rattlesnake in the currency world, highly liquid, and it moves a heck of a lot. The one that I really, the ICE US Treasury Short Bond Index, and I remember when this was listed a couple of years ago, I chatted with your colleague, Johan Erasmus, around it, and he said, look, this is not even going to be a yield play. It's going to be a currency play more than anything else. And it absolutely did what it said on the sticker. If you were looking for rand weakness, you would jump into that and you would benefit from it. But of course, we're now in a new world where we suddenly have yields, and this suddenly becomes, it's focusing on the very, very short-term US bonds, treasuries, but there's yield to be had there as well.
Yeah, if you think about bonds, Simon, they normally refer to duration risk when you invest in bonds. And the longer the duration, the more risk. And we spoke earlier about the capital, the more risk you've got in duration. So the G7 has got longer duration. The ICE US Treasury has got almost no duration because it's equivalent to a money market fund, essentially, in South Africa. We don't label it as money market, but it should be thinking about it as US money market. And with where the yield curve, and especially the shape of the yield curve in the US is, it's quite flat and actually inverted. We've all been hearing around the inversion of the yield curve, which means that your short-dated rates are very much the same as your longer-dated rates. You've got a flat yield curve. So both are offering you the same yield, but the one's got no duration risk and the other one's got duration risk. So what was something that paid zero yield and was a pure currency play is now something that is a currency play plus, let's call it 4.5% short-dated yield in the US. So I think it's become quite an attractive way to play higher yields in developed markets and especially the US without taking the duration risk.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And the one question we had beforehand is, can these be included in tax-free accounts? All of the products we're talking today can go into your tax-free account, and particularly if you're looking for that yield, because one of the challenges is you're earning interest here. So there is, and we're not giving tax advice, and we're not tax experts, but that does have a tax implication, which means that it might actually bond products are often better in a tax-free wrapper.
Exactly. And especially again, coming back to the JSE, we used to on the JSE to refer to anything that pays a distribution to it being a dividend. But you should keep in mind, these are bonds and the proceeds from the bonds, which are the coupons, are seen as income.
Going to looking more broadly at portfolios and you know, we were chatting with Johan and talking around the space that commodities have in a broad portfolio. Bonds have a similar place to play. I mean, is that old classic idea of a 60-40, and when one's doing poorly, the other's doing well, they give you a lack of correlation with equities. That breaks down from time to time. But bonds certainly, particularly developed market, which again, for a long time, simply weren't attractive because there wasn't any yield. But if we look at the environment where a higher for longer interest rate, inflation rate, interest rates, hopefully not going back to zero, because that would imply another global crisis of some kind. Bonds really have really put their hand up to say that they deserve a place in a diverse, balanced portfolio.
100% right. I think we've all seen commentary the last couple of years around the breakdown of the historical correlation between equity and bonds, because as you say, historically, they were negatively correlated. One served as a buffer for the other in certain times, and it was great correlation and it smoothed the profile. That has broken down, and you can argue the reasons for it. But if we go into a cycle that most market commentators are saying the rate cutting cycle is going to be a lot more shallow than what we've seen in, let's say, the post-GFC or other severe crises. A lot of people are calling a US recession not happening, whereas if you go a year ago, everybody was saying an imminent recession. Growth is holding up fairly well. If you look at World Bank forecast, US growth sitting around 2% for the next 2-3 years. So you're going to go into an environment where we're going to start seeing rates being cut, but it's not going to be because we're going into recession and growth is dissipating. So it is going to, from everything you can see, it should be a shallower rate cutting cycle, which means you're not going back to zero. You're probably going to go to something around 3%. If you look at most forecasts, people are forecasting rates to go down to the 3% level in 2026. So you're still going to be yield on offer. So I think you can't ignore bonds, and especially global bonds. And if I go back to coming in from it from a South African perspective, historically, we've invested in SA equity, SA bonds, and global equity. Those were the three things people said. So if I'm going to spend my offshore allocation in a Reg 28 environment, if I'm going to take money offshore, I'm going to go into global equity. I think that picture might change with the new rate environment we're going to go into, and especially where equities are priced and at the moment, especially in the US.
Yeah, that's a great point. We're in some cases, eye-watering levels of equity, although it's a weird market because there's the big tech, which, and this is not a dot-com rally, these companies are underpinned by earnings, which is perhaps the different part. Question that came through is about the ETF, the GGB, which is the offshore one, also came ahead. I was talking around dividends varying a lot. Wehmeyer, we had a look beforehand, and it actually just looks like, because if you go back couple of years ago, there wasn't much yield. So it's just the increase. It was, 13 cents a couple of years ago. now paying over 80 cents a quarter. That's just a factor of those higher yields that we've seen on the bonds.
No, exactly. So if bond yields were 1% 3 years ago and now it's at 5%, you expect your distribution to go from 1x to 5x. And that's what we've seen. So your yield or your coupon that you're going to get on your bond ETFs will directly vary with the yield. But as we said earlier, the yield component might fluctuate in line with global rates, but your capital component is going to fluctuate in the inverse nature on a ratio depending on where the yield is.
Yeah, gotcha. EJ is asking a question, and I don't know that there's a, EJ, that there's a, I know what she's looking for. She's saying, is there a sweet spot to sell bonds when yields are coming down versus capital loss, which has been incurred? I mean, is there, or is it a case of rather through the cycle than trying to sort of exactly say, well, at this point, this is the perfect time to take the or to avoid the capital loss as the yields come down?
Yeah, I think if you talk to most asset allocators, calling the top and the bottom of the asset class cycle is near impossible, because if you had a crystal ball, you would buy bonds just before people are starting to price in rate cuts, and you would buy equity at the bottom of the recession before we go into expansion. So that would be an ideal world. I think it all depends on what you are buying the bonds for. So are you buying it because you've got a view on global rate cycle and you think you can time it? Or are you buying it to construct a portfolio that should serve you through the cycle, rather than thinking about, let's call it trading or gaming the specific asset class? And again, as I said, if you talk to most professional asset allocators, they find it extremely difficult. So from my personal perspective, I would rather think of it as a tool within your portfolio rather than it being something you can game or trade.
Yeah, I take your point. Paul, you're asking if you can put bonds into a living annuity. Absolutely, you can. No problem with that. A question from Johan. He's saying, since the coupon for a bond does not change over the duration, it's a fixed coupon, does implied distribution for a bond ETF also stays more or less the same? And I'm going to say the answer is no, because as bonds are expiring, you're rolling into the new ones. I mean, if we look at the profile of them here, there's some that are you know, expiring in 26 versus some that are expiring in 48.
Exactly. And again, as your bond yield changes, your capital price changes. So your actual yield on your capital from an ETF perspective changes.
Yeah. So there is a question coming from Anonymous. Does one neutralize the other? Yield up, capital goes down. From a total return perspective, and I remember running the math a long time ago, I'll be honest, and there was a bit of slippage, but they almost, I mean, I think the slippage was maybe 50 basis points, but there was almost an offset between the two in many senses.
Yes, subject to you holding it to maturity. So I think that's the big thing around bond investing, especially in a fund context, is if you buy SA government bond today and it's yielding 11.5%, and you are willing to hold it to maturity, which might be 2050 on some of the bonds issued by the SA government, you're going to get 11.5% per annum till maturity, and you're going to be paid out the face value of the bond in 26 years' time. But the nature of pooling bonds together and buying or selling of the actual fund in the interim would mean the direct relationship between yield and capital is not going to hold.
Yeah.
And I guess it's without getting into details, it's the same example as inflation-linked bonds looking attractive at some point. But the merit of that is you holding it to maturity. And I don't think a lot of people have got the patience to hold a bond for the next 26 years.
I was trying to do the math on it. The proper long term. Let's move on to REITs, real estate investment trusts. Here again, we've got a local and an offshore. The local one quite simply distracts the SAPI, which is the 20 big local companies or REITs, property companies on our market. And I always forget that Nepi Rockcastle stands right up there. And of course, that's Eastern Europe. I mean, even Frikelia is in Spain. I mean, once again, we see, and GrowthPoint's got Australia, we are buying SA assets, but in many cases, we are getting beyond our borders of just SA.
We are. I think the turret time SA property counters have gone through the last, let's call it 5 to 7 years, is well known. I think our market is quite concentrated. So if you look at NEPI, between NEPI, GrowthPoint, and Redefine, they, if I recall, they're almost 50% of the index weight. Yeah. So you've got both company specific risk and you've got sector specific risk, because the SA market is very much a retail and office play with a bit of industrial from a subsector perspective. Whereas you go into the global space, you've got a lot of different subsectors and you've got more diversification from a counter perspective. So I think the global property offers South African investors that are looking for property exposure and listed property. A lot of people talk about listed property also being an alternative asset class, because if you think about the pricing, it's more than equity. Mm-hmm. Even though I think SA property market over the last 5 to 7 years have started to price more like equity than to bonds. Because Simon, if you go back 10 or 12 years, everybody spoke about SA property trading at either a premium or discount to SA government bonds, because it was very much thought of as a fixed yield instrument, not worrying about the NAV component. And what we've seen in the last 5 to 7 years is people starting to question the NAVs and NAVs being downgraded due to trading conditions, ability to generate distribution. So I think SA property is trading more like equity these days than it is like bonds. And globally, I would say it's probably a hybrid of the two.
I take your point on that. I mean, I remember when learning about markets, it was always, you bought REITs at discount to NAV, and we can always debate the NAV, but you bought them at discount to NAV, and when yields were above your government tenure, and that totally broke down. I mean, in 2017, yeah, at the peak, I mean, there was significant premium to NAV, and the yields were down in the mid single digits. We've kind of returned to a level of normalcy, notwithstanding. And I'm not saying it is tough being a REIT out there in South Africa, but certainly perhaps a better level of normalcy in terms of valuations around the sector.
Yeah, you've definitely seen, because I think a large part of the downturn in the property market was because yields, dividend yields especially, wasn't guaranteed anymore. I think for 10 years ago, people thought about dividend yields as being guaranteed, and you can think about 6% growth on your dividend yield per annum or on your distribution, which means your dividend yield gets sustained. Whereas that came into question, I think we've now seen a normalization of dividend payouts in South Africa, which means there's probably a more certainty around the dividend yield going forward than there was 3 years ago. Which probably provides you with a more certainty and a better entry point into property than we've seen previously.
Yeah. And I want to come back to the point you made around South African property, fairly concentrated in terms of the counters, but also in terms of it's predominantly retail, office, some logistics coming into it. There's a little bit of residential and other bits, but basically it's a big three. As soon as we switch over to the US, you've got tower businesses that own the mobile towers. You've got data centers. You've got healthcare where they will, for example, own the hospital and the like. It is a much more diverse sector than what we see locally in South Africa.
Definitely. If you just look at the global REIT product, it's got about 330 constituents, so instead of our 20. If you look at the subsectors, and you've mentioned a couple, there's about 12 or 13 subsectors, and they're all fairly evenly spread. If I look at healthcare, is about 10% of the index, industrial about 14%, office only 5%, residential, which we don't have large residential counters in South Africa, that's 15%, retail 70%, data centers being 8%. So it's away from the traditional property market that we are used to in South Africa, and it's actually a lot wider, and it trades more like utility because you've got a lot more certainty, as you say. rather than fluctuating massively from a capital perspective.
And again, the offshore REIT, the GRE, US dominated, I have no doubt. I mean, it's going to be, I mean, as we said, almost any global ETF is going to be US dominated, no different in the REIT space.
Yeah, US around 70% in global REIT. It's only got a third of the counter, so it's got about 100 of the 330 odd constituents, but it's got 70% of the market cap. So again, showing the dominance of the US, because let's remember, property is listed equity. It's the dominance of the US listed equity market. Even though their operations might be outside of the US, their primary listing is in the US.
Gotcha. Yeah. And in some cases as well, I mean, much like I point out to folks, you know, Apple is an American company, but, you know, I'm on Apple product right now. They are sold globally. The question coming through, and this is, again, sort of back to portfolio. And we spoke around how bonds play an important part of a portfolio. And my sort of teaching when I was learning markets and the like was that property does as well. And I know South Africans maybe have a fascination with it, or maybe that is a global phenomenon. But property is also an important part of equity, of portfolios, rather. Again, you get some yield from coming through from it. It's important alongside your equity, your bonds and commodities and the rest as you construct a portfolio.
Exactly. If you talk to asset allocators, a lot of them are, because again, if you go back a couple of years, property, if you looked at, for instance, the SA, CSA high equity category in South Africa, property from an asset allocation perspective actually had a high single digit allocation, 7 to 10% in a growth-like balance fund. Whereas nowadays, that's down to 2, 3% in South Africa. And wow, a lot of asset allocators has actually started to say, my equity manager is going to take care of the property allocation as part of the equity building block rather than me thinking of it separately. Because if you think about sector classification, it actually falls under the broad banner of financials. So you've got property, banks, insurance, diversified financials. So I think SA has fallen out of love with property. But it's sometimes in this... at the height of pessimism, maybe you should start looking at property, as we said earlier, as something that plays a very specific role in your portfolio. Plus, it's not the worst time to think about valuation and entry points if you are comfortable with the outlook.
Yeah. No, I mean, I always, and I like your point, almost sort of, and it's easy for us to sit here and say, and I appreciate it's harder to do, but when things look dark outside, often that's the time to start looking around, because there's opportunity. Yeah. and potentially some pricing coming through. A question coming through, quite simple. What does it mean it's a feeder fund?
So in South Africa, you can set up a global product in two ways. You can either say, I'm going to register a fund with the FSCA and list that as an ETF on the JSE, and I'm going to go and buy the physical underlyings. So again, let's use S&P 500. I'm going to go and buy the 500 companies listed on the New York Stock Exchange. And whenever there's a rebalance, I'm going to rebalance that from South Africa, and I'm going to do a hell of a good job doing it. Or you can say, I'm going to register a feeder fund to say, I'm going to go and buy a single product offshore that is going to replicate the return of the S&P 500, and that's a more efficient way of doing it. So we've gone the route of a feeder fund, and we are feeding into iShares ETFs listed predominantly in London. One of our products goes into a New York Stock Exchange listed ETF, and we're saying it's more efficient for us as a product provider in South Africa to give access to the S&P 500 or global government bond index by using the feeder fund structure rather than replicating it ourselves. And we've been very satisfied that the outcome from the end client is a superior one than us going out there and buying, again, for the S&P 500, the 500 shares.
Yeah. Is that it's the efficiency, which is the key thing. Two questions coming through. Are there market makers? And on all ETFs, there's going to be a, so there's always a, yep, a first couple of minutes of the day and not in the closing auction at, from 10 to 5, but there is market makers at that fair value. And that's one of the beauties. And I stress the fair value is that the fair value doesn't mean we're taking a view on the valuations. The fair value is that this basket of shares relative to where they're trading is a fair value. And another question, these are all RAND-based. And that's the key, the beauty of these is that I buy INZAR on the JSE and you go and convert that and get me the essentially the currency exposure. So I get a dollar or whatever the exposure might be, but I'm getting it in rands and cents on the JSE.
100%. So if you think about any global investment from a South African perspective, and especially listed on the JSE, you should take two things in mind. You should firstly, what is the asset class going to do in hard currency? So again, S&P 500, what's the S&P going to do in dollars? And then what is the rand dollar going to do between me investing and me disinvesting? And the aggregate of those two is going to give you your return in rand from a South African perspective. And that's where our earlier conversation around the view on the rand is important, because it does influence the ultimate return that you get from the investment.
Yeah, because now there's the two moving parts. One is the underlying assets and the one's the currency. If they both go your way, you get sort of like a wind at your back. But if rand strengthening, you get a bit of wind coming into you in that particular
case. And that's where we, Simon, if you look at our fact sheets, what we've started to do is we give you the return of the fund and the return of the benchmark, but we also decompose the return of the fund into what was the currency return and what was the underlying asset class return. So almost being able to say, historically, everybody said MSCI World returns 20%. But you think about MSCI returning 20%, but it was actually RAND doing 10% and the US equity market doing 10% and the aggregate is 20%. So it's thinking about them as two asset classes and me getting the aggregate of those two asset classes.
Yeah, actually I saw that when I was prepping for this and I liked it. Truthfully, I get the full return, but it helps me understand where that return is coming from. So Fiso's asking around, he says, I see a sense announcement sometimes come through where ETFs have been deleted. And my sense is there, Wehmeyer, that's the managing the process on your side, where you're not deleting, you're just constantly reducing or in many cases increasing the number of units that are in circulation. And that doesn't have any impact to me as someone who holds them.
No, exactly. So again, if I think about a listed share on the exchange, so let's take Anglo. Anglo has got a defined number of shares in issue. So when you are buying an Anglo share, somebody else is selling their Anglo share. And the Anglo number of Anglo shares stays constant. An ETF is an open-ended fund, which means you can increase the number of shares in issue. And the listing or the delisting that you are seeing is somebody buying more units from our market maker, and our market maker actually going to the fund and saying, let's create more units. So you're almost creating more shares in the ETF. So that's the difference between let's call it a listed equity and an ETF.
And ultimately that number is uncapped. As you say, Anglo's got a certain amount that's issued and authorized, but in the ETF space, if there's demand, you can carry on creating and listing new units.
Exactly. So people sometimes ask, what's the liquidity of the ETF? And I would say, let's go and look at the liquidity of the underlying market. The ability for a South African investor to buy the 1nvest’s S&P 500 ETF is dependent on how much can we go and create in the US. And that's, I don't want to say infinite, but it's there's quite a lot of capacity.
Yeah, it's more than my portfolio, put it that way. Both
of us combined by magnitude.
Yeah. No, absolutely. Folks, I'm not seeing any more questions coming through, and we are pretty much hitting our time. We'll park it there for today. As I said, the video will be up. Give me a couple of hours. You'll find it on the Just One Lap website. We'll also put it through all the social medias and the like. Wehmeyer Ferreira, Executive Director, 1nvest, really appreciate the time today.
Thanks for having me, Simon. Appreciate it.
Cheers all. Stay warm out there. It is cold. And as always, we really appreciate your time. You could have done a lot of things on your Tuesday morning. We appreciate spending it here. Look after yourself. And if you can, look after somebody else as well. Cheers all.